is actually impossible. You can't get that out of the corners, out of this. You just can't. That's just the unfortunate reality.
Even before plastic and all this, I mean, water was never tested 200-300 years ago. I'm sure it was probably just as bad. They didn't have certain chemicals, and they probably had more lead or some other things in there. You know, but I don't think water was ever 100% clean.
Well, there's a different kind of clean. It's a different kind of clean. If you're drinking something that's like all kinds of bacteria in it, your body immediately throws it out. And you know you're sick, right? And this is still happening all over the world. But when you're drinking radioactive particles, when you're drinking tetrachloroethylene, your body don't throw it out, and you don't get sick immediately, which is actually worse. And a lot of those effects were looking higher risk of cancer, right? So do you feel that? Do you feel, oh, I got cancer growing, I better go do something about it? No, you don't. So which is worse? Right. Next one, please. So I showed this last time for those who are here. So this is an estimation of what 1,000 looks like, right? So how many thousands of football fields can we fill with 1 foot of water? 48,000, right? So visualize that. And how many endocrine disruptors are out there? The EPA suspect over 15,000. 15 times of this. How many chemicals do we actually test? Less than 300. Right? And how many do we actually regulate? Less than half of that. Next one, please. So when you see a picture like this, what do you feel? Refresh, right? Next one, please. So is the rainwater actually clean? So the thing is, once again, if you make a mess in the world, you are not going to get clean drinking water. Next one, please. So here's some of the, I just list this actually from the textbook, some of the major sources of contamination. You know, people always want to know, so what can I do, right? You know, so, we're like screwed, what can we do, right? Well, stop drinking, ban plastic. So if you look at, before you can really figure out what you can do, you might want to look at what are the sources of the problems. So what I really invite you to do is really look at the source of the problems. And once again, what I really wanted to do is hear from you. What do you think you can do? Now, this is also a series. We have a series of four. We started with what's in the food. Today looking at what's in the water. Then we're going to look at what's in your air. Then at the end, we're going to look at what's up with the planet. Right? We really can't really start to talk about solution until we come out to, you know, the very end of the series. Right? So in my view is the house is on fire. If the house is on fire, can you do three things and live in the same house and be okay?
Can you do three things?
Now people are always asking me, why don't you tell me three things I can do? If your house is on fire, can you do three things and stay living in that house that's on fire? That would make it safe. You're way too sensible. We gotta put out a fire. Now, you may or may not agree with me the house is on fire. This is why we're having this series, right? I'm sort of like sharing with you things I've learned. And once again, I'm only presenting very conservative information from the government, statistics from the government, right? So what I'm really looking at is like to have a conversation when we go through this whole series, when we look at all the different pieces, and before we can really begin to see, well, I will let you decide whether the house is on fire or not. And once, if you recognize the house is on fire, do you think you would at least somebody tell you what you can do? I don't think so. I think you know what you need to do. First, you need to understand the house is on fire. But it's up to you to decide, and I really hope that we can continue this conversation, and then we actually like forgive me, yeah.
Huh?
Karen, that maybe we can do something like fantastic or something like that, right? But in the meantime, I really like for you to talk to each other. What can we do? What are some things we can do? Just a couple minutes, please. Yes. Good job. Refuse to buy. Refuse to buy what?
Bottled water.
Bottled water. That's a big piece. Thank you. Right. A lot of cities have already taken action and banned bottled water. Some campuses ban bottled water. They cannot sell bottled water in their on their campus.
Cities have banned.
Oh yes, yes. San Francisco, like the government, you cannot spend any government money and buy bottled water. So, like PCC would not be allowed to spend a penny on buying bottled water. Yeah.
You mentioned last time that you drink tap water.
I drink tap water. I do have water filter also. And Margaret was asking me, so if you go back to the Environmental Working Group website, they have a big resourcing on water, a database on water. They also have a big database on water filters. So you can type in your city, and they can recommend different kinds of water filter for you. And you can type in the toxins you want to deal with or chemicals you want to deal with. They recommend different filters. But if you look at the chart that we show from the environmental, the EPA, they actually recommend to get rid of those toxins, you need a combined carbon filter and a packed aeration tower. And I have not been able to figure out what that is or if it's available for homes. And I've clicked different websites and looked at recommended water filters. They don't look like they have an aeration tower to me at all. I have visited the Burbank site where they treat contaminated groundwater. What they do is they pull it out. They're looking at mostly the VOCs, the volatile organic compounds, including the tetrachloroethylene. What they do is they put it through a different processes, and at the end, they have a packed aeration tower. What that means is a giant, like 30 feet tube, and they run the water, and they turn it like crazy, like agitate it like crazy, so to get the chemicals to come out of it. And they capture it and put it in a tank. And I asked them, where do you take them? They said, oh, some people come and pick them up. I said, so where do they go? We don't know. Magic.
It's just going to
take it away. Exactly. Yes.
What was the website where you could go and get the filter information?
It's the Environmental Working Group.
Oh.
EWG. EWG.
Okay.
I don't remember. If you just type in Environmental Working Group, it comes right up. So talk to each other a few minutes, and I would really like to hear what are some of the things you think we can do. Actually, Donna's got a solution. We all should just start drinking vodka. So anybody wants to share what they sort of talked about, or I know this is not a class, but you know. But I'd really love to hear from you.
We were just talking about,
go ahead.
We were just talking about how the arts are really culpable.
The bad guys are here, guys.
We are. I mean, we're using an enormous amount of energy for everything.
And an enormous amount of terrible chemicals. And consuming a lot of stuff, experimenting. I was looking at it from the perspective of trying to teach somebody, and it's like in teaching them, I encourage them to try something, and to try it, and to try it, and to draw it, and to draw it, and to draw it. Well, in my own professional practice, I avoid printing something until it's done. But I can't tell them not to print it until it's done, because they need to learn how to get it done. You know,
I
it's
see.
Like there's this process of experimentation that is enormously consumptive, even separate from the issue of the materials we use and the energy we used. Just the idea of teaching somebody to get better at it is wasteful.
The process itself.
You know, just the process of teaching is wasteful.
It's just for the recording, because they can't hear you, is that we're saying that in the arts there's a lot of waste, and also in addition to using the chemicals, the process itself in getting perfect. Perfection in the process itself generates a lot of amount of waste. Yes, yeah.
Yeah, things that they're not going to be used for anything down the road, they're going to be disposed, because the last document you get is the only one that you're going to keep.
Yeah.
But every step that you have to take along the way now is to be.
So before the end product, it's just a small percent of the tip of the iceberg of all the material that's been used. Absolutely.
You know, the first 200 pots you throw, or the first, you know, 200 paintings you make, or whatever. You know, it's like there's just like in the idea of getting somebody to do it over and over and over again to get it better. That's inherently wasteful, and yet that's fundamental to the idea.
Well, you first started with step one. Step one is recognizing there's a problem, yeah? That's a really important step, right?
Which has been in the minds of most of the people that work in our area. But the answer seems to be...
Oh, is it somebody else's problem?
Yeah, it's not an easy thing to get hold of.
You're right, it's enormous, it's huge. You know, we were looking at one piece at a time, you put all the pieces together, it's absolutely huge. The problems are very, very big, right? That's why most people are ignoring it, right? If it's easy, people will be doing it. People aren't doing it because it's not easy.
Right? Now, the other day, and I receive every day, but the other day I received the largest school catalog I have ever received. Without exaggeration, it was that thick. Mm. In my division, we received, I think, 100 of them.
Yeah, we each got one in our mailbox.
Right? And so all the art schools throughout the country must have received a catalog for each and every instructor that they have. You're talking about tons of paper that nobody would read. I mean, it went into a shelf or maybe it went into the...
Well,
and that's not something that we produce.
It's a proprietary school. I'm not going to even give it to my students. You know, even if I were to give it to somebody, it would probably get wasted. But I'm not going to give it to anybody. It's a proprietary school that's just out there hustling.
You're absolutely right. And
at any cost.
Yeah, a lot of people have made a comment that we really need to go a lot less paper.
Well,
we need to move towards paper.
This very catalog is online. Mm-hmm. This is the paradox. I mean, you are at the cutting edge of technology and communication. And yet you're using the tool that is completely antiquated.
Do you have some suggestions of what we can do?
Well, I think we should write to them and tell them we will not send them any students as long as they continue to do this.
From where? Where did it come from?
Schools in another school.
From another school.
I see.
Yeah, write them a letter. Thank you very much, but please do not forward to me another catalog.
Oh, great, great. So would
you have the power to do that?
So would you guys be doing that?
Yeah.
All right, okay, one thing we can do. All right, thank you, thank you, woohoo! Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
I can respond to that. Right?
Yes.
It's really a system-wide symptom. If you look at anything, water, plastic, paper, electronics, anything that's created, the problem is you get a lot of excessive production because you don't take into account the cost of handling the material once it's done. You don't look at the whole life cycle of material. You look at the production cost, you look at the shipping cost, you don't look at the disposal cost when they sell anything. So that a lot of times it's taken upon by governments, which means the taxpayers have to pay it, which a lot of like the Superfund sites, that's where a lot costs a lot of money with that. But if it's been designed right in the first place, you don't have to worry about it. So with anything, you need to look at the cost of the impact it has, you know, like with water, what is the cost, the actual cost, the true cost of something, you know, the true cost of paper, you know, the recycling, the production, everything, you know, if what's going to be done with it. And if you charge for people, if you actually charge them so it reflects the true cost of something, then they're not going to be as widely as wasteful because it's really cheap to just print something and mail it, you know. It costs them maybe $1 per catalog, probably not even that, to print it, send it out, ship it and everything. But obviously that $1 doesn't truly represent the cost of the entire life cycle of the product. So
and to make a long story short, it's education, really, that's what's important. The people, I mean, we're not putting the cost to the environment on our price tag. And when the day when we do that, everything will change, absolutely, right? So thank you for bringing that up. And I just wanted to end with a personal story, and I wasn't sure if I wanted to share this. Actually, this is a number of years ago. Long story short, I was in the emergency room. My daughter had been unconscious for many hours. And the doctor told me, well, we've done everything we possibly can. You have two options. You can leave her here with us and we watch her overnight, or you can take her home because there's nothing else we can do. We've done everything. We have done a CAT scan of the brain. We have tested her blood. We have tested her urine. We've tested everything. There's nothing we can do. We found nothing. We have done a complete tox panel. So what would you do if you were in my situation? I asked them, what do you mean by a complete tox panel? They said, oh, we tested for heroin.